So today we'll be looking at the seventh commandment. The seventh commandment, as you know, is thou shalt not steal, or you shall not steal. And it has to do, as the name suggests, as the precept suggests, forbids unjustly taking or keeping the goods of one's neighbor, or wronging him in any way with respect to his goods. Not just to take away the goods of one's neighbor, but also to damage the goods of one's neighbor is also forbidden by its seventh commandment. It also commands justice and charity in the care of earthly goods and the goods of men's labor. And for the sake of the common good, it requires that we respect the rights of others, their right to private property, and also respect that what we call the universal destination of goods. What does this mean? That all goods that God has made for all men, not just for some men, but all of creation is for all men. Christian life, of course, implies that we strive to order the goods, the world goods, towards God and to live paternal charity, as the catechism reminds us. Now, but going to the nitty-gritty of that, the seventh commandment, properly speaking, we see a certain dichotomy, I mean, a certain balance. So, universal destination of goods means that everything is for everybody, but at the same time, that people should have some private property. So, meaning that some things are not for everybody. And so, it is certain, you have to strike a certain delicate balance in these two rules on which the seventh commandment is based. We'll look at the first one, the universal destination of goods. What does this mean? That, of course, as I mentioned earlier on, in the beginning, God entrusted the earth and its resources to the common stewardship of mankind. He did everything for all men. And we should master it and by your labor enjoy the fruits of creation. So that they are destined for the whole of the goods of creation are destined for the whole human race. But at the same time, it is important that each person has a certain private property. Why is private property important for individuals? First of all, that of course, without private property, you can't have people cannot exercise their freedom as persons. Of course, typically when so the converse case, when a person is going to deprive a person of his freedom, one of the first things they do when the person goes to prison is to show that, look, now you have lost your freedom, is that they strip the person of everything the person has. But without private property, it's difficult for one to exercise one's freedom. Not that one's history, but now it's difficult to exercise one's freedom. Also, without private property, a person is a kind of status. That private property or right to private property is attached to the fact that people have dignity, dignity of person. And then thirdly, it's important to have private property to fulfill one's own basic needs, my own individual needs, not that of the community, but the individual needs. And then fourthly, one also needs private property in order to take care not just of my needs, but also the needs of those under individual scale, maybe one relative, one children. That said, so you see that these two principles, the right to private property and the universal destination of goods, rest on something else. We need that we have a common good and freedom. In history, many times people have tended to go to one extreme or the other to say, that right private property is the most important thing, and nobody should have, there should be no common good. And some other cases, they've gone to the other extreme to say that most important that everything is for everybody. The first, or the second case that I mentioned now, that universal destination of goods, when it's overemphasized, historically, we end up with what we know is typical Marxist communist regime, in which nobody owns anything, and because of that, what we mentioned earlier on the dignity of persons that are suppressed, one cannot satisfy his own basic needs, and one loses his own his fundamental freedom because now everything now belongs to the state and nothing belongs to anybody. Also, of course, if we emphasize the other extreme, what do we end up with? In emphasizing the other extreme to say, well, what's important is to have private property. We end up with, say, a pure capitalist state in which every man for himself and God for nobody, we could almost say, where each person is on his own and nobody cares about the person next to him or her, which is also another poor extreme. And so it's important that, of course, that you won't strike that balance between saying, well, that what I have also is also for me to also help the others, but I have the right to private property. That said, we will now look at the second thing we mentioned, that the second commandment commands justice and charity. So, in the care of earthly goods and the fruits of men's labor. And that means that justice and charity, you say, along with that, break this further down to three fundamental virtues that the seven commandment calls us to live. The first virtue is the virtue of temperance, or for the Christian poverty. The second virtue is the virtue of justice, already highlighted above. And the third virtue is the virtue of solidarity, which you could also call in layman's terms charity. And we look at them, each of these three virtues a bit more in turn, one by one. First of all, we'll start with the virtue of temperance. What does temperance call us to do? Temperance calls invites us to live moderation, one attachment to where we live, to deal with them in moderation. Not saying that these things are bad, but not to use them, overuse them so much that one is attached to them, or one's peace, one's happiness lies in possession. And so, it's important to learn to live with a certain detachment from material goods, a certain self-denial, denying oneself of some things that one one has or one could do without, what we call Christian mortification, in food, in drink, in entertainment, in possession. Following the example of Jesus Christ, too, as we see, that from his birth to his death, that he lived a, well, not just a minimalistic life, but that he wasn't attached to material things. And he would even warn Christians of the danger of riches. You know, the parable in Matthew 19:23 refers to that the parable of the rich fool, where it starts with that story where that young man says, "My master, tell my brother to share my goods with me." And then just by now points out, "Well, not put your heart in what you possess." And he now tells them the parable of the rich fool, who said, "Well, I've made lots of money, eat, drink, and sleep, and be merry." And then our Lord now points out, "You fool, this night your soul will require of you." And then miss your goods, who will now take possession of that? Not certainly not the captives. So it's important to then to live a certain detachment from material goods so that one possesses the goods, not that the goods possess the person. Secondly, the virtue of justice, which simply puts that constant and firm will to give to everyone what is their due. So not just to say not to owe anybody anything, but also to say, well, I give to each person what I owe the person. Which at times is money, at times is goods, at times is respect. Classically, they usually divide the virtue of justice into three parts: commutative justice, distributive justice, and legal justice. What does this mean? The commutative justice has to do with the justice between two equal individuals. Equal or not so equal individuals, but between individuals. So that the father owes his son, for example, to take care of the child, material, of the son owes the father respect and obedience. That's commutative justice between individuals. I borrow 20 naira from this friend of mine, then I owe that person 20 naira and I should return 20 naira to him. That's commutative justice between individuals. Distributive justice, as the name implies, has to do with a certain distribution of goods. That usually from an authority to subordinate, so that the state, for example, owes the citizens a certain social amenities for the state taxes, and so they have to distribute the money of the taxes in an equitable manner to the people that arise there. The same way, too, maybe in an office, the boss loses distributive justice to the people under that are working for him. So it has to do more with an authority we have power to solve that. That is distributive justice. Legal justice is the reverse, in the sense that it has to do now with individual citizens or subordinates to the superior. And that's why it's called legal justice, thinking more of that relation between citizens and the authority. So, of course, that the citizens should pay their taxes, should participate in politics, should obey the laws and the laws of the land, and that way they are living that legal justice. So, in summary, that the justice are three parts: commutative between individuals, distributive between it, superior to subordinate, and then legal subordinate to superior. Then we come to the third virtue, the third important virtue, which is the virtue of solidarity, which sometimes in some circles is simply referred to as charity in some circles. What is solidarity? Is that firm and persevering determination to commit oneself to the common good. And that concern for the others. Which many times we see in many organizations that we say, well, let's see if we can help before make a collection in the parish for some individuals, raise some money for some welfare project. They're living solidarity, that concern for those who are in need. But not just to limit oneself to think that the common good or their needs are simply material. Sometimes the needs of the others end up being quite spiritual good, which are equally important. Maybe at times people are lonely, or maybe a person needs to go back to the sacrament, or a person needs prayer. So at times, not to say, well, I don't, not just to be solidarity by giving good, but also by praying for the other. And then we link that with the tradition of the church. We talk about the seven works of mercy, the corporal works of mercy, and the spiritual works of mercy. One more mercy: feed the hungry, give drink to the thirsty, shelter the homeless, clothe the naked, visit the sick, visit the prison, and then bury the dead. Well, in the spiritual works of mercy, what are they? To counsel the doubtful, instruct the ignorant, admonish the sinner, comfort the afflicted, forgive offenses, bear wrongs patiently, and pray for the living and the dead. And these are the seven spiritual works of mercy. Having said that, now we can now focus on the second half of this class, which has to do with the things that the seven commandments forbid. We looked at it that the seven commandments encourage the virtue and justice, solidarity, and temperance. But the seven commandments, which are said, we forbid unjustly taking the goods of one's neighbor or wronging in any way that we are unable to respect his good. But it goes beyond that. And your respect for the goods of the others means that, of course, I forbid theft, understood as taking the good of one's neighbor, the goods of one's neighbor in a hidden way, stealing. It also forbids robbery. What is robbery? Now, robbery is theft by violence, that a person, in addition to taking the goods, also say, maybe just now, not in a hidden way, but an open way, threatening the person. It forbids fraud. And what is fraud? Now, fraud is taking the goods of the others by cheating that person through false scheme, false document. What really many times in Nigeria they refer to as 419. So, that even though the person, maybe the person may end up giving the person the money, the money, but again, because he has been deceived. So the aspect of fraud is what marks out fraud from the other, as you see, is the fact that the person is deceived into doing what he would not have done if everything was clear to him or her. Then there's usury. What is usury? Usury is collecting a greater interest than it takes in for the amount borrowed. So, and usury, why is usury bad? I don't know if it's bad to take interest from others, but it's bad when one takes advantage of the needs of another person in order to charge an exorbitant interest. And so again, it's forcing that person to pay an interest that the person will not have paid if the person had options. For example, maybe the person is stranded, he needs to pay, I don't know, maybe school fees or something in a very short time span. And the only person he can borrow money from, and he now says, okay, fine, I'm going to charge you, maybe going interest rate is maybe 10 and 20%. I will charge you 40% interest if not, you don't get it. So the person, because the person is desperate, agrees for something that under normal circumstances you will not have agreed to. And that's just taking advantage of the needs of the others in order to charge an exorbitant interest. Again, you could go further to specify more things. Goes against speculation. What is speculation? Speculation is when one takes advantage of the others through information, privileged information that the person has, in order to take advantage of the others. For example, I know that they're going to increase the crop price tomorrow, and so I stop selling today. And then I now, the following day or a few days later, I now start selling at double the price, knowing that people have no choice but to buy from that speculation. That takes advantage of insider information in order to extort from the other. Corruption. Corruption is, again, taking from the others, but now in the situation where the person asks for some financial compensation in order to carry out a task that ordinarily you should carry out without charging, without any extra charge. And so denying the person of his rights. For example, admission, the person meant to get admission, and then through false pretenses, the person expelled from that other person in order to get undue influence. So it works both ways. Either to collect money from someone to give him something that is due, or use one's own undue influence to unjustly give somebody what is not to do. That is corruption. Then also using appropriation and use for private purposes of goods that belong to the public or to one's company. Let's say a person typically goes to the office and then uses the things of the office to do his own private business, or uses the goods of where he's working to run another company completely. And so you're appropriating, or maybe the government official that takes the things of the government and carries them to the house and give it in order to run something that is not the purpose of those amenities. So stealing from the enterprise, from the government, or whatever, for other reasons. Also, work poorly done goes against the seventh commandment. When a person works poorly and still collects the same money or the same remuneration for the job that is poorly done, he's stealing from the employer or from the person that pays him or her. Tax evasion is also goes against the seventh commandment as well. He's stealing from the common to the public. Forgery of checks and invoices. At times the person may hide maybe an invoice that's got in order to get more remuneration for money that he has not spent, similar to fraud. Also, when a person makes excessive expenses or wastes food, money, amenities, stealing either from money, from public funds, or at least or from maybe one's company, or even if the person says, "Well, this is mine and it's mine to use, maybe my own food, and I waste food I have," it goes against that virtue of poverty that we spoke about. And it also goes against that universal destination of goods. So, well, in the sense, yes, these things I have them, but I have them for my own use, for my dignity, and also in order to help others. And so when I waste it, I'm actually stealing from the others, you see, that person, stealing from the others, because the people need this. So rather than wasting, you see how to give it up. Then there's willfully damaging private or public property. And this one is quite good. There's more. Plagiarism or intellectual theft. It's also good on the seventh commandment. Paying unjust wages. So now it's the employer that steals from the employees by paying less than they deserve. Right, the paying less than they deserve when they're giving, they're doing a lot of work for it. Again, it's important to keep this in mind because it's not just enough that, I don't know, I call somebody and I agree maybe a transfer worker and I say, well, can you call this one for me? And the person is desperate. And I say, well, I'll pay you, I don't know, peanuts, so 50 naira. Of course, the person is desperate, the person agrees. I say, well, since you agree, I'm paying you something just. Things are not just simply because you are green. Because again, you can take advantage of the need of someone. It's important considering it to at least have an idea what a just wage is. Not to knowingly take advantage of the needs of others in order to pay them on just wage, but only take advantage maybe that the person is an imbecile and stupid in order to unjustly pay the person. And then, sorry, I didn't put this well, but these are contracts not kept. Any person does not keep his own part of the bargain in the contract. For a typical contract, I've agreed to do a certain job for a certain remuneration. And so, I pay that remuneration, but I do not finish everything that was stipulated for no reason. Then I'm stealing from the other party. Same applies with promises that are not kept. I think that's one. There are squares and blank. Now, look at an interesting, I think, it's becoming more and more common these days, the issue of gambling. You ask many people, well, the jury's out about the morality of gambling. People tell you, well, gambling, especially those who gamble, of course, were humans, and of course, if you gamble, are more likely to defend gambling than if you don't gamble. If there's a long gamble, I tell you, the ones who say, I reckon that the gambling is bad. What are you considering to say? I'll read it slowly and then we'll analyze it. It says about games of chance, card games, or wagers, are not in themselves contrary to justice. They become morally unacceptable when they deprive someone of what is necessary to provide for his needs and those of others. But stop the effect. To gamble is not bad in itself. It's not against justice, it's a game of chance. They become morally unacceptable, but when they deprive someone of what is necessary to provide for his needs and those of others. So imagine a father or family takes his weekly wage or monthly wage, a good portion of it to gamble, and because of that, he deprives his wife of money to cook, or he deprives his children of their school fees, or part of their school fees, or he's not able to pay the rent of his house because he has gambled, because he has used that money to gamble. Then it will go against justice, because justice implies the fact that he gives to the person he's here, because he has people in his charge, or maybe he deprives him of something that's worth. He needs to get for himself. Then let's continue. So that's the first thing, that is not by himself, it does not deprive the person of something that he needs, something that's necessary to provide for one's needs or those of others under the person's care. But it continues, it says that, well, to qualify it further, that the passion for gambling risks becoming an enslavement. So it's not enough to say, well, what I'm gambling, I'm not depriving anyone of anything, but be careful not to fall into enslavement and addiction. That gambling is addictive. So it's important to see, well, if I know that fine, what I'm spending is not going to go against justice, oh well and good, and I can keep it that way, there's no problem. But it's likely that I'm going to become addicted and thus perhaps gamble more and spend more than is better that I don't even start. Finally, it's now asked that all that unfair wages and cheating at games constitute grave matter. Unless the damage inflicted is so slight that the one who suffers it cannot reasonably consider it significant. So, of course, I think this third part is clear, but unfair wages and cheating that gambling is not by itself. But maybe I have a way of cheating the people I'm gambling with, or making bets that taking advantage of the stupidity of the other just put it that way in order to unfairly get money from them. So it's not a fair wager, or not one that a devil thing. It's no longer a game of chance. Maybe I have a way of getting, of influencing the results in my favor. And then, it is similar to speculation again. When maybe a person knows, okay, the stock market, I buy the stocks and I can influence the stocks in such a way, the market in such a way that my own stock will make money. So it's not fair on the others who will make money. So again, by gambling, it will be bad. Even if the person is not depriving others or something, if the person is cheating or unfairly, so influencing the game in such a manner that is likely always to win. So that's it. I will just end with a story that to put in context. I remember some years ago, I had to speak with a friend who was right to speak with him, who he had, was addicted to gambling, an elderly man. And he said, well, I mean, the fact that I don't enjoy watching a football match if I have not put some money down to gamble. He said, well, I think this is how it's going to be. I don't enjoy it. Maybe there's nothing at stake. So we got talking and I said, well, what the problem is not you enjoying the game. The problem is that you are putting so much money and using so much money and so depriving your family of what they need. So we came up with a solution that I thought was fair. Instead of trying to meet their passion to enjoy the game. So why don't you let your wife decide what to gamble? And because initially it was a bit upset, but then saw the sense in it. And he said with his wife, I knew his wife that well, like he liked to drink a cold beer every Sunday. So he said, okay, fine. Gamble your bottle of beer. That way, fine. And I get two bottles of beer if your team wins, or you get no beer at all if your team loses. And that way, that is the passion of enjoying the game and having put something down, you don't miss it. But then again, you don't deprive those that you need what. Those that are under your care, what they need. So that's all I have to say about gambling. Now, the last thing we see now has to do with the peculiarity of the seventh commandment, which is the need to make restitution. What is that commandment? When a person goes to seek forgiveness, of course, we try to submit amends as best as we can. But the seventh commandment is the commandment in which restitution is an obligation in order to receive forgiveness. At least not restitution of the will to make restitution. So anyone who has committed an injustice must make restitution for the injury caused to the extent possible. So if I've taken something now, maybe one, you know, a person may have borrowed something from someone, borrowed in quotes, and has now kept it forever and ever. And then people realize, well, I actually deprived this person of this. So I have to, I'm sorry, Lord. But let me just say, I'm sorry, and I still keep what I'm taking from that person. It's not enough. A sign of that sorrow is that will to return what I've taken. So, the extent possible, you want to be person that I've been taking from. So, the restitution of what has been stolen, while it is desire to make restitution, is necessary for forgiveness. Of that the peculiarity of the seventh commandment. And the duty of making that restitution is an urgent obligation. And when a person culpably delays it, the person increases, of course, the injury to the person owed and the guilt of the debtor. So, but then again, it may happen that the person is the physical or so moral impossibility of making restitution. Physical, two senses. One, that What I sold, I do not have it anymore. I've spent it. Just I stole money from my association and I have spent it. Money that they kept, gave it to people and I've spent it. So what do I do? Oh, I stole money from my company and I spent it. I don't have it. So well, it's a physical impossibility. So maybe to see, well, why don't you schedule and see if you can pay it back later by this. So if, at that moment, it gives you a person, but you have to see over time it's possible. Even if it's little by little. Again, another physical impossibility may be that fine, what I stole or what I kept back, I can return it. But the problem now is that the person to return it to, I cannot find that person anymore. Maybe the person years ago, the person has died, the person has moved, I have lost contact with the person. So what do I do in that situation? Well, these are the two possible physical impossibilities. That I don't have the what is stolen, or I don't know where the person is. So in the first case, return little by little, or when I get it to return it, they find a fine way, of course. But in the second case where I cannot locate the person, well, maybe locate someone that is close to the person, or if not, it is impossible to give it to the poor. Now, the moral impossibility of making restitution refers to a situation where it's impossible for me to return this without being, accused and then eventually maybe in prison. That one doesn't have the obligation to, let's say, money has been stolen from the company has discovered, and I come and say, okay, you know, it's not obliged. It's not as if it's bad to do so, but one is not obliged to come out and say, okay, I know that they did arrest me. What one is obliged to do? Morally speaking, to return it. So if the person realizes that morally speaking, if I return this, I will be prosecuted and so on and so forth. The person doesn't find an equivalent way of returning what has been taken. Without necessarily revealing one's identity. It's an anonymous donation, whatever it may be. This is also part of the mind. I know this particular part may give rise to many questions, which unfortunately the comment is not possible to answer, but I mean it's there a lot of creativity. A lot of creativity in the sense of looking for ways to return it, but one has to have said that we have to return this as soon as possible. Because the obligation to return can be cancelled. If the debt is followed by the creditor. Because there's no, the person says, I don't know if you do, but forgive you, forget about it. Or maybe after a while, the person decides meritoriously to go and reveal himself and say, if I stole it from you 10 years ago, and the person says, don't worry. So I'm not obliged to return it anymore. So that's what the obligation can only be cancelled by the person that is. I think with that, end this class. I hope you enjoyed the class and you made the most of this time.